good to see everybody out this morning. We'll get you a song book. Stand, turn to page 133. Y'all feel like traveling on 133.
Thank you. I guess it's good sometimes to surprise the choir leader. Put him on the spot, how's that? Appreciate the choir this morning, appreciate them singing for us, and was laughing. Y'all wouldn't believe how good it sounds up in the fellowship hall over the speaker up there, your choir. And so sometimes those that are in the parking lot may want to go in the fellowship hall. They're welcome to do that. Yeah, socially distanced, and if they want it, or in the Sunday school rooms, we have it, those on the speaker too. You can listen in there. If it's too cold and stay in the parking lot and you'd like to come in, you can do that as well. And any of you, and matter of fact, if you want to be in the fellowship hall, you can see, we can set it up as closed circuit. You can see the picture, it'll be on the TV and hear it all. So any that want to come in, we'll work it out to where you can do that. We'll just do it that way if you'd like to. And pray for those, as I said, that are not here. We have, with this pandemic, and I hope it'll soon be over, so we can do things we want to, like we want to. I am sort of bothered with part of it. I guess I could say bothered with it. It just keeps plaguing us. It's in a lot of our churches. A lot of our folk in the county have been affected by it. Noticed what he's sharing with me is, the other day, that three out of one family had died, all of them adults, and all of them in different households, but it's one family that died from COVID. So we know it's real, but I hope it'll soon be gone, or we can get rid of it so we can go back and worship God like we want to. I was talking with some of the members that are afraid to come because of age and health-wise, and they were sharing with me they was missing the church greatly and love to be back, but are afraid. Not only are they afraid to come to church, they're afraid to go to the supermarket, they're afraid to go anywhere, and their kids are buying their groceries and setting them on the porch and letting them get it, and so they do fear it because of health reasons that they have other complications, and so I understand it, but pray that God can work it out and this thing can end. God may be trying to tell America, I think he's trying to tell us some things, and we're so hard-headed sometimes we don't listen very good. We just go on about our way and say it's just a way of life. It's not. God's trying desperately to get America's attention. The end's growing close, and America just turns a deaf ear and walks away. Church, be careful that we don't do it, that we stay where we should be with God. God's trying to get things in order. You read the last book of the Bible, then you go look at the signs of the time that are around it. And the Bible tells us when all these things are coming to pass, look up, our redemption draweth nigh. Folk, I believe it's time we begin to look up. God's coming. It won't come from Washington. Even our help won't. It won't come from our down in Raleigh, but thank God it'll come from heaven. And so I'm glad to know that I serve the one that can take care of all the problems. And boy, when we hear the shout of the voice of the archangel and the church gets ready to leave, boy, what a day it's going to be. For two or three funerals here for a few days, they've sung that song. What a day it'll be. Folks, Paul wrote and said that we which was alive and remain would not prevent those that were coming. They were coming back, those that sleep in the Lord. They'd be called up first, and then we'd join them in there to ever be with the Lord. So our day is not far away, and we're to be rejoicing. We're to, as I shared with you last Sunday morning, boy, we're to be worshiping him. He's real, and he's got things under control. Now, we may look at the dark side of it, but the bright side is, boy, we're getting ready to go home. We should be excited about that. Those of you that have your Bibles, turn with us in 2 Chronicles. I want to, the 34th chapter, want to read maybe one verse and share with you some things. Talk to you about the youngest king of Israel and Judah by the name of Josiah. He was 8 years old when he was elected or put in the position of the king. Became a very, very godly individual. the first 8 years of his kingship or his lordship over the promised land, he began to study and learn all he could about how David lived. Now, folks, if you read about David's life, he really set up and began, for the first time, he united all the Jewish people, and they all worshiped God together under a united kingdom. And then it went for a while, they were split, had different kings and all of this. But then, due to death, Josiah became the king at 8 years of age, and he wanted, I think, in his heart, from what I can read as you're reading 2 Chronicles about his life, go back and read the other scriptures as well. His ideal was to build their country to be a Christian nation. He wanted it to be like it was under David, that they would come together, they'd worship in the tabernacle or the temple of the day, they would come together and they would dedicate it to God, they would, and for reasons Christ had not died yet, offer the sacrifices they did. His main objective was to get rid of false worship or idols. Now, folks, I'm gonna say this to you. I liked our former president, and I hope the one that's elected, if sure enough they is elected and they certify him as president, I hope he'll lead America toward God. I'm worried about it, but I'm praying that God will get hold of him. Now, folks, let me tell you something. The God I serve can change people. And now, we might, from the all previews, doesn't look real good at times, but boy, God can change things. When we pray, when God's people get down to business and pray, God can change things. And I believe the church should be praying. Now, God said, I raise up who I will and I abase who I will. God's allowed things to happen, but you and I can, through prayer and talking to God, God can change the things that are there. So, folks, they're not to be our idol. President Trump, as good as he was not my idol. But a lot of people thought he was the only person in the world. Let me tell you something. God's the true king. He's the one that's got everything under control. Now, Josiah, in that day, they had set up false worship. They had idols. They even had carved wood carvings and set up in places, and they meant to worship that. They worshiped everything coming and going. Josiah began his kingship by destroying the false idols that was in the land of Judah and the land of Israel of the day. He was tearing down these idols. In America, and boy, I'm gonna get where we live in a minute. This is my introduction to you. We've got some idols we need to tear down too. Believe it or not, if we're not careful, we may not have a statue that we set up and worship. But anything, now I want you to hear me good on this, anything that comes between us and worshiping God is our idol. There's a lot of things that rob it. Let me say this, and heaven help that I'm not just picking on one sport, but when they started having the ball games on Sunday morning, they started having the car races on Sunday, and the stadium was full when they could. They're like everything else now, they can't. And about 90% of those were church members. Now don't get upset at me. It came between them and going to church. It became their idol. You and I got, sometimes we let little things get between us and God. When we do that, boy, we've done let an idol set up in our life. nothing, I mean absolutely nothing, should ever come between us and coming and worshiping God. We should put Him first. This is the house of God. This is a place that's set up for worship. And boy, the church ought to be faithful to it instead of the other things of the world. Now, all kinds of sports has got on. They think it's all right. We'll do it on either on Wednesday night. We'll do it on Sunday morning. The church will come anyway. Guess what? They was right. We've become guilty of going and doing other things that took us away from God. And it becomes an idol. We're going into the holiday season. And I like being together with my family. There's nothing wrong with that, but boy, we are to pray. We are to pray together as a family. Instead of, what are we doing, Thanksgiving? Well, we are to say, God, we're going to pray. We're going to be thankful. Santa Claus is not what Christmas is all about. Well, we're to be teaching our children. It's about the birth of our Savior. It ought to be that ought to be our idol that we set up. Boy, we are to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Instead of allowing little things to come in. In 2 Chronicles, the 34th chapter and the 7th verse. When I begin to read this, I want you to, matter of fact, when you get home, if you think I'm not pointing you in the right direction, you read this whole chapter. Nothing but the things that he did to get rid of the idols in Israel's life. You and I have room to work on in our Christian life. Little things that come in. The great psalmist, or Solomon as he was writing, he said, it's the small foxes that spoil the grapes. It's the small sin that slip in. Those little idle things, those little things that sort of come between us and God are what's destroying our church today. Let me say this. I know we have a pandemic going, but I tell you what, it should not have hurt our churches, but it has. Those that sometimes let me say this. I want you to understand what I'm talking about. There's a difference. But these people, it's not darkened the church door since it happened. Using that even for an excuse to stay out of the house of God. Folks, we're letting everything come between us and God. And I believe it's time the church woke up and realized where we was at. We're getting in trouble. And it's going to get worse if America and the churches in America don't open their eyes. God's trying to point it out to us. He's trying every way he can to show us that we need to move these other things out and put him back first. I don't know about you, but maybe I'll get to the scripture after a while. But folks, what he done for me, he should always be number one in my life. I don't know about you, but I can remember the feeling it was when I realized I needed a Savior. I'd have give anything to have the peace I know now. I'm glad I got a peace. If tomorrow comes, okay, I know who holds tomorrow, and if it don't, boy, I know where I'm going. So I want to keep these little things out of my life. That I can be what he wants me to be. That I can worship him and praise him. Get this stuff out that's coming between me and him. little things in her. Gary done a wonderful job teaching this morning on our prayer life, how we should pray for one another. If we're not careful, we allow Satan to put our things in our life to keep us so busy, we don't even have time to pray like we should. So you see, a lot of things can become idols in our lives, can hinder us and bother us from being what we should be for God. Josiah said, let's get rid of them, let's tire it out, let's reprove it, in the seventh verse. And when he had broken down the altars and the groves, and had beaten the graven images into powder, and cut down all the idols throughout all the land of Israel, he returned to Jerusalem. So actually, what I'm reading in that, they had them spread out everywhere, almost like America. We have set up so many things that robs us of our time to worship God, and we got them scattered all around. I said a moment ago, all the sports, activities, even our high schools, there was a time in Ashe County when a high school would not have set a game on a Wednesday night because that was church night. Then they found out the church will come if we have it any time, so now it's midweek, we'll have our sports on Wednesday night. Then we wonder why we have a pandemic, why we have, and folks, I'm gonna put it where it is, why we have the highest suicide rate per capita of any county in North Carolina. We've took our eyes off of God. We've got them on everything else and left God out of the picture. And we have our little idols we built up that we worship instead of worshiping true and the living God. So Josiah said, if we're going to be what we need to be, we're going to have to get some idols out of the way. Church, if we're going to have revival, if we're going to have church and win people to Jesus Christ and see them come to know him in the free pardon of sin, we're going to have to clean up a little bit. Under the revival under Hezekiah, said he commanded the priest or the Levites of the day to carry the filthiness out of the church, then they had revival. So church, it's not so bad. Maybe we say we're not so bad, but being like the world is not so good either. God said to come out from among them and to be a separate people, to be a peculiar people. To have different standards, to get things out of our lives that don't belong there. Put God first. Now, I said a moment ago, I appreciate our prayer warriors. I appreciate people praying for me to no end, and I know they do. Hallelujah. I can feel it. I appreciate that. But if we're not careful, Satan will get us so wrapped up in what we're doing every day that we forget to pray. We don't take time to pray like we our forefathers did. How many of you on the way to work, church this morning, and I don't want you to hold up your hand, had a prayer on your mind that you were praying? When I was a young fella coming, you could hear people praying. They walked to church, they didn't ride. I was telling Gaynor the other night, we was riding by, and I was telling her, I said, when I was growing up, there was probably one car in the parking lot. No reason he did, he was elderly and couldn't get here, he couldn't walk to get here. But few had a car and walked, and they prayed on the way to church. They come, they were ready to worship when they come through the door. And here we are with all of our modern convenience, can't get up early enough to spend time praying and talking to God. We've allowed other things to become our idol, take our mind off of it. Every day, our jobs, you know, we have to get up and I remember how it was when we got up every morning, we'd rush around trying to get ready to go to work and be to work on time. Didn't have time to pray because we hadn't got up early enough to do it. They said they took prayer out of school. I told you some time ago they'd never take prayer out of school as long as they were tests. And some of you know what I'm talking about. They'll be praying. But we've about let it leave out. Heard a preacher make the comment the other day, and I thought how true it is. They were having online school and all of that now. Wonder prayers back in school now. Do we pray in our homes? Do we put God in our schoolwork? You know, they can take it out of the school, but we're the one took it out of our home. We're going to be blessed by God. We're going to have to get rid of the things that are in there and put prayer back in its place. Come back to Him. Not only are we going to be faithful to church, we're going to be faithful to our prayer life. Not only that, we're going to have to be faithful to the things God's called us to do. Now, you may not be called to be a preacher. If you are, as Brother Herbert Caldwell said, you ought to surrender and get in with both feet. God needs you. But let me tell you something. God's calling a lot of us to do other things. God's calling people to use their talent like never before. Some of you have got wonderful talents. You can do a lot of things. I smile and think about Doug, my older brother. He could have talked to anybody. It didn't matter where he's at. Some of you are the same way. You can have a great testimony for God. Took him hunting with me. I knew some of the people by name, but not really knew much about them. Took him with me, and he didn't care what he went hunting. Not he was just going to be with me. Took him out on the hill, and me and Rex, the younger one, was going on up on the mountain, and I looked around, and Doug wasn't with us. I said to Rex, I said, where'd Doug go? He said, last time I saw him, he was down here talking to that 86-year-old fellow sitting on the log. We was gone 2 hours, come back, he's still sitting right there talking. He knowed all about them folks, but when he got back, some of you have that talent too. You can just talk to anybody. God's needing you to share your message of Christ with them. I'm sure they talked about it. I found out a little bit later about the man that's 86 years old. He was hadn't served as a deacon until he got so old he felt like he couldn't in the church. And they sat there and talked about the Lord on that long. After they got everything else talked about, they began to talk about the Lord. He was sharing with me that afternoon when we sat out to camper. He began to tell me about what he was talking about the church, what their churches did. Let me tell you something. God can use you to share you the message. God can use you too. So he wants you to not only be faithful to church, he wants you to be faithful in your prayer life. He wants you to be faithful to the call that he's got for you to do. Now some of you, he's calling you to use your talent. Boy, I want you to do it. When we come to church, sometimes we come, we think, well, we got to rush through the Sunday school ending, the intermission. We got to hurry, and the choir's got to hurry up and sing out of the way, and then you got to preach. Folks, sometimes we're missing what God wants us to do. God may be telling you to do something. I want you to feel free to do it. Mind God. It's nothing but a testimony. As Mike stood up last Sunday morning in the choir and began to tell how God had been with his family. How God give him some assurance. Boy, God's real. He wants us to worship him and praise him. He may have done something for you in the last week that you should have stood and lift your hand toward heaven and let the world know what God's doing in your life. He's wanting us to be faithful to Him. He's wanting us to get these other things out of our life so He finds His place, where we can put Him in the right place in our lives. Let's move all this other stuff out and put God first. So our church can go on for Jesus Christ. We can see others come to know Him, and we can be a great witness for Him. Let's yield to God. Let's put these other things in their place. The Word of God simply says, put the kingdom of heaven first, all these other things will be added unto you. There's time for other things, but God wants to be number one. I hope you'll put Him number one. We're going to soon be going into the long holiday seasons. Let's make a determination God's going to be number one in our holidays, that we're going to put Him first, that there'll be none of these idols that'll come in. Thursday, Thanksgiving Day, is not the only time to pray, not the only time to be thankful. If you're alive and well and your family's been blessed, every day should be Thanksgiving. Man, boy, I'm going to say this. Some of these that went home to be with the Lord, my, how thankful I am to know that they knew the Lord. I'm glad I know where they went, and I can go be with them. So let's be thankful for a lot of things, even though we've had tragic after tragic thing. If I know Him, well, we still got something to be thankful for. Let's worship Him. Let us stand. Please pray. Father, I thank You for the day. God, I pray right now that we can make a determination in our hearts, Father, that we're moving anything out that's got priorities above You. Father, we want to put You first. God, how good You are to us and how You've blessed us. Father, I thank You. Even during the time of death, Father, You've not left us. You've been there. You said You'd never leave us, and Father, now we've been tried. We saw You through it all and how real You could be. God, I want to be thankful to You as we start the Thanksgiving season, maybe a few days early. God, I want to be thankful to You. Father, I want to be thankful that You allowed me to be born in a country where I could meet You as my Savior and worship You. Father, where the gospel so readily advanced, Father, for anyone that listened. God, thank You for allowing me this privilege. Father, I thank You for the church and for Your people. I thank You, Father, for the prayer warriors that are here and how You pray for us. Father, I thank You so much. God, I ask You now that You'd go with us throughout the day. God, help us in our own minds to look at the things that are becoming idols in our life, robbing us of joy, Father, robbing us of time to serve You. Help us to be like Josiah, Father, to cut down, remove, get away all idols that are in our lives. Help us, Father, to be true to You. And then, Father, may we say, here we send us, Father. Use us with the talents we have, whether it's to sing, whether it's to talk, whatever term, Father, that we need. Use us, Father. Help us to be witnesses. Touch those that are lost. God, may something be said or done, cause them to realize their need of Jesus, and may they come to know You. God, I pray now, have Your way. We'll give You honor and praise, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. There we go. May God bless you is our prayer.
they're going to do.